In response, the Government of India has decided to extend the pension benefit to about 3 crore retail traders and shopkeepers whose annual turnover is less than 1.5 crores under a new scheme, namely Pradhan Mantri Karam Yogi Man Dhan scheme. Enrollment into the scheme will be kept simple, requiring only Aadhaar and a bank account, and the rest will be on self-declaration. We recognize that investment-driven growth requires access to low-cost capital. It is estimated that India requires investments averaging 20 lakh crores of rupees every year. A number of measures are proposed to enhance the sources of capital for infrastructure financing. A credit guarantee enhancement corporation, for which regulations have been notified by the RBI, will be set up in 2019-20. An action plan to deepen the market for long-term bonds, including for deepening markets for corporate bond repos, credit default swaps, etc., with specific focus on infrastructure sector, will be put in place. It is proposed to permit investments made by FIIs and FPIs in debt securities issued by infrastructure debt fund, non-bank finance companies, the IDF, NBFCs, to be transferred, sold to any domestic investor within specified lock-in period. Corporate debt markets are crucial for the infrastructure sector. Given the need to further deepen bond markets, a number of measures are proposed to be taken up. To deepen the corporate tri-party repo market in corporate debt securities, government will work with regulators, the RBI and the SEBI, to enable stock exchanges to allow AA-rated bonds as collaterals. User-friendliness of trading platforms for corporate bonds will be reviewed, including issues arising out of capping of International Security Identification Number, the ISIN. It's right time to consider increasing minimum public shareholding in the listed companies. I have asked SEBI to consider raising the current threshold of 25% to 35%. As a key source of capital to the Indian economy, it is important to ensure a harmonized and hassle-free investment experience for foreign portfolio investors. Hence, it is proposed to rationalize and streamline the existing Know Your Customer, the KYC norms, for FPIs to make it more investor-friendly without compromising the integrity of cross-border capital inflows. It is time to take our capital markets closer to the masses and meet various social welfare objectives related to inclusive growth and financial inclusion. I propose to initiate steps towards creating an electronic fundraising platform, a social stock exchange, under the regulatory ambit of Securities and Exchange Board of India, the SEBI, for listing social enterprises and voluntary organizations. For listing social enterprises and voluntary organizations working for the realization of a social welfare objective, so that they can raise capital as equity, debt, or as units like a mutual fund. It is important to get retail investors to invest in treasury bills and securities issued by the government. Efforts made by the Reserve Bank will need to be supplemented with further institutional development using stock exchanges. For this purpose, interoperability of RBI depositories and SEBI depositories would be necessary to bring about seamless transfer of treasury bills and government securities between RBI and depository ledgers. And for enabling this, the government will take up necessary measures in this regard in consultation with RBI and the SEBI. FDI inflows into India have remained robust despite global headwinds. Speaker sir, global foreign direct investment flows slid by 13% in 2018 to $1.3 trillion from $1.5 trillion in the previous year, the third consecutive annual decline according to the UNCTAD's UNCTAD's World Investment Report in 2019. This is India's FDI flows in 2018-19 remained strong. If that was the global picture, India's inflows in 18-19 remained strong at $64.37 billion, marking a 6% growth over the previous year. I propose to further consolidate, Speaker sir, the gains in order to make India a more attractive FDI destination. A, the government will examine suggestions of further opening up of FDI in aviation, in media, animation, ABGC and insurance sectors in consultation with all stakeholders. 100% foreign direct investment will be permitted for insurance intermediaries. Local sourcing norms will be eased for the FDI in single brand retail sector. Single brand retail sector. It's high time India not only gets integrated into global value chain of production of goods and services, but also become part of the global financial system to mobilize global savings, mostly institutionalized in pension, insurance, sovereign wealth funds and so on. The government is contemplating organizing an annual global investors meet in India using National Infrastructure Investment Fund as the anchor to get all three sets of global players, top industrialists, corporate leaders, top pension insurance sovereign wealth funds, top pension insurance and sovereign wealth funds, and top digital technology and venture funds also. An important determinant of attracting cross-border investment, Speaker sir, is availability of investable stock to the foreign portfolio investors. This issue assumes greater significance in view of the gradual shift from stock-targeted investments towards passive investment, whereby funds track global indices composition, of which depends upon available floating stock. Accordingly, I propose to increase the statutory limit for FBI investment in a company from 24% to sectoral foreign investment limit, with option given to the concerned corporates to limit it to a lower threshold. FPIs will be permitted to subscribe to listed debt securities issued by the REITs or the InvITs. Even though India is the world's top remittance recipient, NRI investment in Indian capital markets is comparatively less. With a view to provide NRIs with seamless access to Indian equities, I propose to merge the NRI portfolio investment scheme route with the foreign portfolio investment route. New and innovative financial instruments have been launched in the last 5 years, like Infrastructure Investment Trust, the InvITs, which I referred to a minute ago, Real Estate Investment Trust, the REITs, which I referred to a minute ago, as well as models like Toll Operate Transfer, the TOT, as part of the Brownfield Asset Modernization Strategy for augmenting infrastructure investment. India has had a reasonable success in brownfield asset monetization, and several InvITs and one REIT transaction have already been completed. Additionally, the National Highways Authority, NHAI, carried out one TOT transaction as well. The cumulative resources garnered through these instruments and model, Speaker Sir, exceed 24,000 crores of rupees. India has emerged as a major space power with the technology and ability to launch satellites and other space products at globally low-cost level. Time has come to harness this ability commercially. A public sector enterprise, namely New Space India Limited, NSIL, has been incorporated as a new commercial arm of the Department of Space to tap the benefits of the research and development carried out by ISRO, Indian Space Research Organization. The company will spearhead commercialization of various space products, including production of launch vehicles, transfer of technologies, and marketing of space products. Sir, I've all the while spoken about the various means through which we can, at a macro level, reaching the $5 trillion target. Now, I would just confine myself to talking about Grameen Bharat, the rural India, the various steps which we'll take towards strengthening our economy. Mahatma Gandhiji had said, the soul of India lives in its villages. This year, even as we are marking the 150th birth anniversary of Mahatma Gandhi, I submit that our government keeps Antyodaya at the core of all its efforts. At the center of everything that we do, we keep Gaon, Garib or Kisan. Matlab, Gaon, Garib or Kisan Kendra Bindu hai hamare har ek karyakram mein. Honorable Prime Minister's two mega initiatives of Ujjwala Yojana and Saubhagya Yojana have transformed the lives of every rural family, dramatically improving ease of their living. Household access to clean cooking gas has seen an unprecedented expansion through provision of more than 7 crore LPG connections. All villages and almost 100% households across the country have been provided with electricity. A combination of efficient implementation and enthusiastic adoption has significantly improved access to energy for rural households. By 2022, the 75th year of Indian independence, I would like to assure the nation that every single rural family, except those who are unwilling to take the connection, except, Speaker Sir, it's important to understand, except those who are unwilling to take the connection will have an electricity and a clean cooking facility. Pradhan Mantri Awas Yojana, Grameen, aims to achieve the objective of housing for all by 2022. A total of 1.5 crore rural homes have been completed in the last 5 years. In the second phase of PMAY Grameen, during 2019-20 to 2021-22, 1.95 crore houses are proposed to be provided to the eligible beneficiaries. These houses are also being provided with amenities like toilets, electricity and LPG connections. With the use of technology, the DBT platform, the Direct Benefit Transfer platform and technology inputs, average number of days for completion of houses has been reduced from 314 days in 2015 and 16, it took us 314 days, Speaker, sir. Now it is only 114 days. Please allow me to repeat this. If the completion of houses required 314 days in 2015-16, in by the time it was 2017-18, it has now come down to only 114 days, and that is why the scale of our achievement is possible. Fishing and fishermen communities are closely aligned with farming and are crucial to rural India. Through a focused scheme, the Pradhan Mantri Matsya Sampada Yojana, the Department of Fisheries will establish a robust fisheries management framework. This will address critical gaps in the value chain, including infrastructure modernization, traceability, production, productivity, post-harvest management, and quality control. Pradhan Mantri Gram Sadak Yojana has brought many socio-economic gains in the rural areas. To accelerate the speed of achieving universal connectivity of eligible habitations, the target of connecting the eligible and feasible habitations was advanced from 2022 to 2019 itself. I am happy to inform that all-weather connectivity has now been provided to over 97% of all such habitations. This has been possible by maintaining a high pace of road construction of 130 to 135 kilometers per day in the last 1,000 days. Committed to the agenda of sustainable development, 30,000 kilometers of Pradhan Mantri Gram Sadak Yojana roads have been built using green technology, waste plastic and cold mix technology, thereby reducing the carbon footprint. With the changing economic scenario, it is important to upgrade roads connecting villages to the rural markets. For this, Pradhan Mantri Gram Sadak Yojana Phase 3 is envisaged to build, to upgrade 1,25,000 kilometers of road length over the next 5 years, with an estimated cost of 80,250 crores of rupees. 1,25,000 kilometers of roads will be upgraded under Pradhan Mantri Gram Sadak Yojana Phase 3, and the amount estimated for this is 80,250 crores. Considering the fact that majority of people still live in villages and depend on agriculture and traditional industries, the scheme of Fund for Upgradation and Regeneration of Traditional Industries, SFURTI, Spurti is it, aims to set up more common facility centers to facilitate cluster-based development to make the traditional industries more productive, profitable and capable for generating sustained employment opportunities. The focus sectors are bamboo, honey and khadi clusters. The SFURTI envisions setting up of 100 new clusters during 2019-20, which should enable 50,000 artisans to join the economic value chain. Further, to improve the technology of such industries, the scheme for promotion of innovation, rural industry and entrepreneurship, Aspire, has been consolidated for setting up of livelihood business incubators and technology business incubators. The scheme contemplates to set up 80 livelihood business incubators and 20 technology business incubators in 2019-20 to develop 75,000 skilled entrepreneurs in agro-rural industry sectors. We will invest widely in agricultural infrastructure. Speaker, sir, we will support private entrepreneurship in driving value addition to farmers' produce from the field and from those from allied activities too, like bamboo, like timber, from the hedges, and also for generating renewable energy. Annadata kyun urja data bana nahi sakte? Annadata urja data banane ke liye bahut sare hamare programs hain. Daring through cooperatives shall also be encouraged by creating infrastructure for cattle feed manufacturing, milk procurement, processing and marketing. Speaker, sir, I place my appreciation for our farmers who have made India self-sufficient in pulses. Dalhan ke revolution jo hamare kisan ne kiya pichle 1.5 saal mein kiya hai, uske liye unko main badhai dena chahti. I am sure they will repeat such a success even in the production of oil seed. Tilhan mein bhi hum ummeed rakhte hain hamare kisan aise hi safalta payenge. Our import bill shall be reduced by their seva. We also hope to form 10,000 new farmer producer organizations. That will ensure economies of scale for farmers over the next 5 years. The government will work with state governments to allow farmers to benefit from e-NAM. The agricultural produce marketing cooperatives act should not hamper farmers from getting a fair price for their produce. Ease of doing business and ease of living both should apply to farmers too. And we shall go back to basics on one count. Speaker, sir, I would like to draw your attention. We shall go back to basics on one count. Zero budget farming. Zero budget farming may not be a new thing. That is why I said we'll go back to basics. We need to replicate this innovative model. Some states have already tried somewhat. We need to replicate this innovative model through which in a few states farmers are already being trained in this practice. Steps such as this can help in doubling our farmers' income in time for our 75th year of independence. Ensuring India's water security and providing access to safe and adequate drinking water to all Indians is a priority for this government. A major step in this direction has been constitution of the Jal Shakti Mantralaya. Integrating the Ministry of Water Resources, River Development and Ganga Regeneration and the Ministry of Drinking Water and Sanitation. This was done by integrating these many ministries and departments. This new Mantralaya will look at the management of our water resources and water supply in an integrated and holistic manner and will work with states to ensure Har Ghar Jal. Har Ghar Jal to all rural households by 2024 under the Jal Jeevan Mission. This mission under the Department of Drinking Water and Sanitation will focus on integrated demand and supply side management of water at the local level, including creation of local infrastructure for source sustainability like rainwater harvesting, groundwater recharge and management of household wastewater for reuse in agriculture. The Jal Jeevan Mission will converge with other central and state government schemes to achieve its objectives of sustainable water supply management across the country. The government has identified 1,592 blocks which are critical and over-exploited. Spread across 256 districts for the Jal Shakti Abhiyan. Besides using funds available under various schemes, the government will also explore possibility of using additional funds available under the Compensatory Afforestation Fund Management and Planning Authority, the CAMPA, for this purpose. Speaker sir, Swachh Bharat Abhiyan has touched the very conscience of the nation besides bringing enormous health and environmental benefits. This noble scheme, initiated in 2014, has achieved a resounding success. 9.6 crore toilets have been constructed. Since October the 2nd, 2014. More than 5.6 lakh villages have become open defecation free. We have to build on this success. We must not only sustain the behavioral change seen in people, but also harness the latest technologies available to transform waste into energy. I propose to expand the Swachh Bharat mission to undertake sustainable solid waste management in every village. Under the Pradhan Mantri Gramin Digital Saksharata Abhiyan, over 2 crore rural Indians, have so far been made digitally literate. To bridge rural-urban digital divide, BharatNet is targeting internet connectivity in local bodies in every panchayat in the country. This will be speeded up with assistance from Universal Service Obligation Fund under the public-private partnership arrangement. Speaker, sir, till now I focused on some specific features in order that our rural India, Gramin Bharat ke liye. Now I will focus on Shahri Bharat, urban India. This government sees the rapid urbanization of India as an opportunity rather than a challenge. We have to make both our cities and villages better using technology. This way, we can help people live closer to their homes, stop migration into cities, provide essential services to all. Under Pradhan Mantri Awas Yojana, urban, over 81 lakh houses with an investment of about 4.83 lakh crores have been sanctioned, of which construction has started in about 47 lakh houses. Over 26 lakh houses have been completed, of which nearly 24 lakh houses have been delivered to the beneficiaries. There is large-scale adoption of new technologies for construction of these houses. Over 13 lakh houses have so far been constructed using these new technologies. More than 95% of our cities also have become ODF. Open defecation free. 95% of all cities have become, or they have declared themselves ODF. More than 45,000 public and community toilets across 1,700 cities have been uploaded on Google Maps, covering more than 53% of India's urban population. Almost 1 crore citizens have downloaded the Swachhata app. The 150th birth anniversary of Mahatma Gandhi is an apt occasion for us to rededicate ourselves to the ideals of the Mahatma. Honorable Prime Minister took the sankalp of achieving Gandhiji's resolve of Swachh Bharat to make India open defecation free by 2nd October 2019. I am very satisfied And I'm very happy to report to this august house that this would be achieved by the 2nd of October. To mark this occasion, the Rashtriya Swachhata Kendra will be inaugurated at Gandhi Darshan, Rajghat on 2nd October 2019. A Gandhipedia, like encyclopedia on Gandhi, a Gandhipedia is also being developed by National Council for Science Museums to sensitize youth and society at large about positive Gandhian values. Indian Railways suburban and long distance services do a phenomenal task in cities like Mumbai and smaller cities. Railways will be encouraged to invest more in suburban railways through special purpose vehicle structures like rapid regional transport system proposed on the Delhi Meerut route. I propose to enhance the metro railway initiatives by encouraging more PPP initiatives and ensuring completion of sanctioned works while supporting transit-oriented development to ensure commercial activity around transit hubs. We are in the process of completing the dedicated freight corridor project that will free up some of the existing railway network for passenger trains. Speaker sir, allow me now to speak on the youth of India. The government will bring in a new national educational policy to transform India's higher education system to one of the global best education systems. The new policy proposes major changes in both school and higher education, among others, better governance systems, and brings greater focus on research and innovation. We propose to establish a national research foundation to fund, to coordinate, and to promote research in the country. NRF, or the National Research Foundation, will assimilate the research grants being given by various ministries independent of each other. NRF will ensure that the overall research ecosystem in the country is strengthened with focus on identified thrust areas relevant to our national priorities and towards basic science without duplication of effort and expenditure. We would work out a very progressive and research-oriented structure for the NRF itself. The funds available with all ministries will be integrated in NRF. This would be adequately supplemented with additional funds. Massive online open courses through Swayam initiative have helped bridge the digital divide for the disadvantaged section of our student community. To upgrade the quality of teaching, the global initiative of academic networks, GYAN, program in higher education was started, aimed at tapping the global pool of scientists and researchers. The imprint or impacting research innovation and technology scheme began as Pan-IIT and IISc joint initiative to develop a roadmap for research to solve major engineering and technology challenges in selected domains needed by the country. Higher educational institutions are becoming the centers of innovation. These initiatives have upgraded the quality of education. There was not a single Indian institution in the top 200 in the world university rankings 5 years back. I repeat, there was not a single Indian institution in the top 200 in the world university rankings for 5 years back. Due to the concentrated efforts and concerted efforts by our institutions to boost their standards and also to project their credentials better, we have now three institutions two IITs and IISc Bangalore in the top 200 institutional bracket. This is a window open now thanks to all our efforts. We will continue making concerted efforts to improve the performance of our institutions of higher learning. An amount of 400 crores has been provided under the head World-Class Institutions for the year 2019-20, more than three times the revised estimates for the previous year. More than three times the revised estimates of the previous year. India has the potential to become a hub of higher education. I therefore propose to start a program, Study in India, that will focus on bringing foreign students to India in our higher educational institutions. The regulatory systems of higher education would be reformed comprehensively to promote greater autonomy and focus on better academic outcomes. A draft legislation for setting up of Higher Education Commission of India would be presented in the year ahead. Khelo India scheme, launched in October 2017, has created awareness of sports as an integral part of wellness throughout the country. The government is committed to expand Khelo India scheme and to provide all necessary financial support. To popularize sports at all levels, a national sports education board for development of sportspersons would be set up under Khelo India scheme. Sir Speaker, this government recognizes and follows the teachings of Lord Bashveshwara. This government recognizes and follows the teachings of Lord Basaveshwara, in particular the principle of Kayaka and Dasoha. Implementing Kayakeva Kailasa, the government enables about 10 million youth to take up industry-relevant skill training through the Pradhan Mantri Kaushal Vikas Yojana. This is helping to create a large pool of skilled manpower with speed and high standards. Demographic trends worldwide show that major economies will face severe labor shortages in the future. To prepare our youth to also take up jobs overseas, we will increase focus on skill sets needed abroad, including language training. We will also lay focus on new age skills like artificial intelligence, Internet of Things, big data, 3D printing, virtual reality, and robotics, which are valued highly both within and outside the country and offer much higher remuneration. Drawing again on Lord Basaveshwara, his principle of Dasoha underlines most things this government does. Give it up for giving up LPG subsidy, or the various pension schemes, or on the principle of sharing through distribution for the wellness of society, which is what Lord Basaveshwara did even earlier in a millennia ago. The government is proposing to streamline multiple labor laws into a set of four labor codes. Sir, for the sake of labor welfare, I like to repeat this slide. The government is proposing to streamline multiple labor laws into a set of four labor codes. Codes. CODES, codes. This will ensure that process of registration and filing of returns will get standardized and streamlined. With various labor-related definitions getting standardized, it is expected that there shall be less disputes. We propose, again, sir, this is an interesting idea, I wish to draw your attention. We propose to start a television program within the DD bouquet of channels, exclusively for startups. This shall serve as a platform for promoting startups, discussing issues affecting their growth, matchmaking with venture capitalists, and for funding and tax planning. This channel shall be designed and executed by startups themselves. Later in the speech, I shall deal with taxation matters of the startups. So, Stand Up India scheme has delivered enormous benefits. The country is witnessing emergence of thousands of entrepreneurs, from women and also from scheduled caste and scheduled tribes. Most of them assisted to set up their own businesses and industry with capital provided under the Stand Up India scheme. Considering the beneficial results of the scheme and strong demand for its continuance by the SC and ST communities themselves, the scheme would now be continued for the entire period coinciding with the 15th Finance Commission, that is 2020 to 2025. The banks will provide financial assistance for demand-based businesses, including, for example, for acquisition of scavenging machines and robots. Sir Speaker, the Stand Up India scheme has made human dignity and self-esteem to go up. Kaikeva Kailasa, I said earlier, and I repeat, the Ministry of Petroleum and Natural Gas has enabled SC and ST entrepreneurs in providing bulk LPG transportation contracts to them. In a matter of 2 years, over 300 entrepreneurs have emerged as a result of the Stand Up scheme. Machines and robots have been deployed to do scavenging, which also saved the manual scavengers their dignity. The synthesis between Stand Up and Startup, with commercial banks playing the catalyst, has brought this transformational change. Sir, now I shall concentrate a few paragraphs on ease of living. After all, everything that this government does with the principle of minimum government, maximum governance is aimed at getting ordinary citizens' life a bit easier. So the ease of living is a very important principle. This government aims to bring greater ease of living in the lives of its citizens. Digital payments are gaining acceptance everywhere, including by the government. Use of technology is an effective way to ensure this. Pradhan Mantri Shram Yogi Mandan was launched on 5th March 2019 by the Honorable Prime Minister in Ahmedabad. The scheme aims at providing 3,000 rupees per month as pension on attaining the age of 60 to crores of workers in unorganized and informal sectors. About 30 lakh workers have already joined the scheme. For good quality of life and ease of living, maintaining a cleaner environment and ensuring sustainable energy use is absolutely vital. A program of mass scaling up of LED bulbs for widespread distribution